use of those is statutory in nature. So the liquor code has carved out probably your, the same concern that you're having, is that no information can be stored off of that, that card.
It was kind of interesting getting carded. Well, that was pretty funny.
We represent a lot of the convenience stores and grocery stores in Pennsylvania, and it's just been across the board. So hopefully, if it's new to this area, everyone will get used to it.
My lady does that girl, and she goes, listen, I got to do it. I got to do it to everybody.
Yeah. It is. It's not a liquor code requirement. It's a correct way to do it. Yeah, it's Wawa's policy, and it protects not only the public, but the associates, too. It really removes the gray area from having
to. Right, helps them, and they don't get trouble, sure.
Is there anything else you needed to say, or can I ask supervisor discussion?
Sure.
I have a question, but I think Mr. Coleman will have a question. First question, you said, first of all, the total liquor license, you're only going to be selling beer and wine, even though you used the word primarily in your presentation?
Yes, and you're correct. With a restaurant liquor license, they would be permitted to sell spirits. They do not do so, since they can only sell spirits for on-premises consumption. They cannot sell it to go. So since they don't really want to sell anything for on-premises consumption, they do not keep any spirits in their stores.
So that could happen eventually if Wawa decided to change their business model?
Well, it would be twofold. Wawa would have to change their business model to be more of an on-premises atmosphere, or the liquor code would have to be amended.
Which would be a change in general use as well.
And the second question I had, you talked about 8 ounces of wine or 2 12-ounces of beer. Is there a time limit on that? Or can they leave, come back, expand again?
Great question. I don't think so. I don't think that they have even a policy to consider that, since in the past I've had discussions with their licensing team that the 23 stores that allow for this, I think it's like 1% of alcohol sales is consumed on premises. So, like I said, their associates are trained to watch for anyone drinking there. Since it happens so infrequently, I would like to think they would notice if someone walked back in and walked out. They do have to purchase it in advance. They can't open it and then buy it later. There's really no table service. So they would have to purchase it first. So hopefully they would recognize someone coming back in to consume more.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The question I have is, you said that the card people, now that when they card someone, is if their license is not valid, does that mean they're denied?
That's correct.
Okay. I wanted to make sure that was the way it was, that if they didn't have a valid driver's license, that they were denied. I don't care if they're 21 or 41.
So there will be signage that says exactly that.
Okay.
It says a valid government-issued driver's license.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Jeremy, you got a question?
I think it's 3 questions. One is, there's also a food availability requirement. Obviously, you're going to have food around, but my question was, is that area also going to double as sort of eating inside?
Yeah, that's correct. And they have seen the tables utilized more for that. I think what they're finding is people aren't eating in their cars anymore. They're just eating at tables provided there.
Okay. That's what I was looking for, and you'll have food available, obviously. I'm not sure if we have a scan of this, but could you go to the seating, because it says 30 seats, I'm counting 22. How am I missing?
There's booths right behind one of the areas of seating. You'll see it's sort of up at the top of the seating area. There's a long line. That's all booth seating, so that will count towards the seating requirement. Do you want to show you?
No, I can see. Okay. I now see that there's a booth there, so it's 10.
Any other questions?
No other questions.
Okay. Any other questions? From the public?
Is it like the Wawa that's at the Superstore?
Yes.
Okay. Because I know exactly what it looks like.
Yeah. It would be very similar to that. I don't think Superstore has a beer cave. I think it's a slightly different model, but essentially the same with the seating area. Yeah.
This is a larger store.
Yes. Yes. Correct.
Okay.
You need to make a decision this evening. So you have to render your decision within 5 days of the hearing. So you're not going to meet within the next 5 days. Yes.
Okay. Is there any concerns or is there any recommendations from my fellow board members? many, many Wawas, and I've been to several that have this layout, the same usage. I'm okay with it as long as everything is done the proper way. And I do mean, I expect anyone that does not have a valid driver's license to not be served.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I mean, I'll put on the record, they have a perfect record with the liquor control enforcement, and that's 100% due to all the policies that they put in place and maintain.
Okay. So
I have a resolution that that we prepared in advance, approving it, and be now therefore portion of the resolution and for the whereas clauses. The West Rockville County Board of Supervisors approves by adoption of this resolution the proposed intermunicipal transfer of liquor license number R-21366 to West Rockville Township by Bylaw Inc. for a civilly located intersection of Mead House and Golden State Road in California. So if you wanted to adopt that resolution, you would make a motion to adopt resolution 2023-11.
I thought we just did 11, yeah.
Yep.
It would be 12, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it would
be 12. No, it would be 11.
Okay. Okay, so then we'll go back and change it.
No, I was just kidding.
Okay.
All right, 12, and here.
Here's
the order. 2023-12.
Okay. All right, so with that being said, then I'll entertain a motion for approval to move forward with this resolution.
I'll make that motion.
Mr. Collingwood made the motion.
I will second that.
Mr. Shermer second. All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
And I'm going to pass these down for you to sign now, so because we also have to communicate it.
Okay.
And so she can take it with you and sign it.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. It's Sir Greg and Jason. Oh, still my report. Okay. Second item on the solicitor's report. At the last meeting, you reviewed the Veris final plan submission. You authorized the preparation of a resolution consistent with that review. There is a resolution.
Excuse me. I apologize. We will get copies of that resolution.
Yeah, I'm going to
give her one.
That works. Thank you. All right. Sorry, ma'am.
No problem. This is their
yes.
Final plan approval. There's a plan approval resolution in your packet, and if you are inclined to adopt that resolution, you make a motion to adopt resolution 2023-13.
All right. We have a
I'll make that motion.
We have a motion made to adopt resolution 2023-13. We have a second.
I will second that.
Okay, we have a motion made in a second. All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Ayes have it.
Thank you. And you also reviewed the land development application of triple net investments for a warehouse on Quarry Road, and that resolution is in your packet, and if you were inclined to adopt it, you would make a motion to adopt resolution number 2023-4.
Okay, we've all seen this. We've all gone through this.
Yes.
I'll entertain a motion for approval.
I'll move.
Okay. Mr. Shermer has moved.
Second.
Mr. Collingwood is second on 2023-14. All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Ayes have it. Thank you.
Thank you. Then the final item on the solicitor's report tonight is a review of an ordinance that PRA, Centers Regional Authority, sent to us in the WWE. Talked about briefly at your last month's meeting, the ordinance that they sent, staff has some concerns with, namely the scope of the area that they were providing. So there is a black line and a clean copy of that ordinance in your packet. What it says now, what it says now is instead of defining the area of the service area so broadly, or the mandatory connection area so broadly, it says that the mandatory connection area would be along Bethlehem Pike, and there is another road. What's the other road? Do you know, Steve?
Paper Road.
Paper.
Well, now I want to make a correction there, because that should read Old Bethlehem Pike, not Bethlehem Pike. Bethlehem Pike is the old 309. Am I correct?
But there's a portion of Bethlehem Pike.
Okay.
That is, they got more grant funding, so they're going to get the ones that are the wells that are contaminated on Bethlehem Pike.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Which will also be off.
So it's going to be Old Bethlehem Pike, Bethlehem Pike, and Paper Road.
Okay. Thank you.
No, I was there.
Yeah, that's correct. I just wanted to make sure we're clear on the difference between the two.
But what it's saying, what the ordinance that we're bringing to you would say is that the parcels that need to connect or have buildings and along the water line that's being extended for the purpose of remediating the PFOA and PFOS contamination, and that the connection has to be at no cost to the resident. Right. But that once connected, they'll have to pay sewer rates.
Correct.
And if DEP orders, they will have to seal their wells.
That would be a DEP issue, not a township issue.
Not a township issue.
Correct. Making sure everyone's aware of that. But I do want to, this is a question that was asked to me, making sure there will be no cost to the residents, so long as they do it now.
And usually when you do a sewer line project and there's no cost to the resident, it means that they take it to the curb,
yeah,
and your plumber is in the house.
Right.
This project will bring it into the house at no cost to the resident.
Okay. So work on that.
Yeah.
Thank you. I know this has been a big issue, you know, for many, many people but the people that are up there, especially on Tabor Road. Okay? We're good? So
the next step would be to authorize advertisement for a public hearing and notify the residents that they have the chance to put into the public hearing.
Okay. All right. So I'll make a motion that we authorize advertisement.
Second.
Motion's been second. Comments? All those signify by saying aye?
Aye.
Aye. Ayes have it.
And this will either be advertised for probably for your June meeting. The only thing that holds it up for July is if we have trouble getting all the names and addresses of the people that have to be notified.
Okay. Very good.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
That is all I have for the solicitor's report.
Wow. Good. Well, at least you had quite an answer there.
I did.
Yeah.
I took longer than 6 months. Yeah. My goal was a lot shorter.
All right, with that being said, I would grant a motion for approval on the solicitor's report as presented.
I'll move.
Of Mr. Sherman, the motion. Second by Mr. Collingwood. All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye. Thank you. All right, next on the agenda is the manager's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The item is consideration of EIT Sterling Act resolution. Back in 1832, the state of Pennsylvania passed the Sterling Act, which gave the city of Philadelphia the right to charge current income tax to anyone who works in the city. So if a West Rockville resident works in the city, they get charged 3.448%. It goes all to the city of Philadelphia. And West Rockville Township receives zero. In your packet is a resolution asking the state of Pennsylvania to change that and asking the city of Philadelphia to remit the 1.75% of the income back to the local municipalities and school districts. They could keep the balance. So all municipalities in the Buck Montgomery area are passing this, and if the board wishes, they can adopt this resolution.
Okay. Well, I will say, personally, myself, I think this should have been a long, long time ago. The money should
The resignation is Mr. David Collingwood, who's going to serve as the liaison.
Okay. All right, so we have a recommendation on the floor. Is there a wish to forward with the resignation? I'd entertain a motion for approval. Okay, what's been made? I'll go second. As long as you're okay with this.
We have excellent candidates. From a personal perspective, it's a chance to grow the CT younger.
Okay.
And less is more, because even though I will not be formally on the conservation committee, I will still be delayed on.
Yep.
So I'm still going to be involved.
You'll have input.
Yes. It's all good.
Okay, so we have a motion made second to move forward with this request. All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Ayes have it. Thank you. All right, next on the agenda is old business. Anybody have any old business?
I have just a question. Is there any update on 729 Bridge, the building of the fire?
No new updates. They're still working.
Okay, I don't have any new business.
I have none.
None.
I have none either. Public comment. I'll open the floor for public comment. If you have public comment, please state your name and address after being recognized. Yes, ma'am.
Karina Willing, 217 Thousand Acre Road.
Okay.
Could I come up here?
You could, yeah.
Or I can be here.
Whatever makes you feel more comfortable.
I had three separate topics to present, but I see that Greg already changed one. I thought the lectern should be moved so that we could see and hear the speaker, because it was a real problem with their back to us and then presenting things. Anyway, topic number one. I think the arbitrary 2.5 minute limit for a resident or a visitor to comment is not appropriate. Last month, an elderly gentleman, as far as I know, he was at the meeting for the first time, was interrupted in the middle of his comment. He was not a person who regularly speaks or usurps time. I think Greg should have the ability to use his discretion to end a resident's comment and not rely on this artificial rule. If it is a rule, it should be amended. Perhaps for 5 minutes, I would start. Now, my most important suggestion, a zoning addition or amendment to our local firearm laws. In 1970, zoning was established in West Rockville Township. The population then was approximately 2,500 residents. Zoning laws were in place and observed by residents. Gun laws, however, were not on the books, but were the federal laws, followed by the township. So it remains even now. It's time to change. Today, the population has doubled to over 5,400. Density has increased to a point where the danger of accidental shooting is great. There are individuals who shoot for hours using automatic weapons, discharging them repeatedly on quiet weekends in the day or evening hours. Last Saturday, an individual discharged firearms for 3 hours, ending his joyous hobby with an explosion that shook our house. Our normally quiet, sedate feet totally can jump. And we all know by now about the cataract tracker. There, a gun was used until dusk. Last summer, I approached the police chief at the Historical Society picnic to express my concern.
2.5 minutes.
Sorry. You can. Can I finish?
It's the chairman's duty to get 2.5 minutes. I will allow you to proceed on briefly. So go right ahead.
Last summer, I approached the chief at the Historical Society picnic to express my concerns after again suffering through the disrespectful firing of a weapon or weapons for hours. He he could not help me, his hands are tied. Specific local gun laws do not exist. Gun owners have rights, but so do I, and the rest of our residents. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for your public comments. All right, next, anybody else? Name and address, Mr. White.
White, Allentown Road.
I want to make it clear, if you do not want to state your name and address, your ability to speak in public comment may be eliminated.
Okay, that's what I'm here to talk about.
Okay.
So, as a condition on my First Amendment free speech, I must give my home address at this public meeting. What I am trying to present and prevent is this community getting sued. Problem is, nobody's listening. So what I have here is Marshall versus Amuso, a civil action in federal court in Philadelphia. The judge was Gene Prater, and this is a preliminary injunction. The preliminary injunction was issued because the case against Pennsbury School District had zero merit. The part that affects us is what Judge Prater said about having to give your address. Requiring the speaker to announce their specific home address is an unreasonable restriction. Simply provide their township when signing in. The chilling effect of being forced to announce to all present one's actual home address before speaking on a hotly contested issue is clear. Now listen, there was a mass shooting 100 yards from my bedroom. There are mass shootings just about every day. There are more mass shootings this year than there were days in the year. You are putting me and my family and this community at risk by naming us to our address. You guys don't give your address. The loss of the First Amendment freedoms for even minimal periods of time unquestionably constitutes irreparable harm. So this part's from Delaware Valley Journal. Linda Stein wrote this stuff. The Pennsbury School Board has agreed to pay $300,000 settlement on that case. $300,000 they paid. The attorneys were the Institute for Free Speech. They're just working to, keep free speech. So the other things that were said were the court also ruled against the board's requirement that speakers publicly announce their home address before beginning their remarks. The lawsuit was to protect our constitutional rights as codified in the First Amendment. The judge's decision now stands as a precedent that other citizens can cite. I'm citing it. So here's the thing. The case never went to trial. The case never went to trial because the school district fired their solicitor, hired another one, and settled the case for $300,000. They settled because there was no legal position. The position had no merit.
Yeah,
your
time is up.
Okay. Our supervisors are putting us at risk by lawsuit, and it will be a slam dunk lawsuit.
Thank you for your comments. Are there any other public comments?
You want me to go?
Please.
Yep. Stan Howard, 10,000 acre road. A couple things. The one I know you're not going to be able to do. But one-lane bridge down by the Twin Churches, is there any way of getting signage put up there to get, five cars through each time? Because, boy, that backs up all the way up Allentown Road, coming around 5 o'clock. And instead of this one-car crap, you could have, if they had signs that you let five through, it would be a lot quicker. That's the first thing. The second thing is, I don't know the house number on our road. I can't tell you exactly where it is, but there are a couple of areas on our road that the ditches, because the road has eroded, the sides have eroded really bad. Somebody goes off there, it's going to be, they're certainly not going to get out of it. They're not going to get out of it looking good. Even if you even if it was just stone put in there or something like that, it drops all the way back because the road, as they were breaking off, and when you go around Carter's Corner, sometimes when the buses are coming around, it tight squeezes. And the last thing is, Thousand Acre Road is a, it's in this area, correct? It's residential.
Yeah.
Okay, please look out for our interests. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you for your comments.
Okay, any other public comments?
Right.
Seeing none, I will entertain a motion for adjournment into executive session, which we will be holding.
I will second it.
Okay, motion made and seconded. All those signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Thank you all coming. Thank you for giving your input.
Thank you.